that will kill a meeting. If you're going to have intercession, what we've found is the focus prayer. Our focus at night is on nothing except to find out what God's will is for us to pray, and to pray only the things that he wants us to, pertinent to revival or over nations. Sometimes he will lead us to break strongholds over nations and do things like that. But we only move according to what he shows us to do so that we are fully focused. These other things will be a distraction. They're wonderful things to pray about, and there needs to be a time and a place to pray. But we're talking about intercession. We're not talking about a prayer meeting. You might even have to have two meetings. Okay? When I saw the streets of gold, I said, Lord, why? He said that was to be the nature of the intercessor. They had to have the nature not to be a gossiper. They had to have the love. They have to have the love to cover anything that God shows, no matter what it is, to be able to cover it in love, without judgment, and to pray for the person. The second thing that will destroy, so I'll complete that thought, will destroy your prayer meetings or your intercession times, will be lack of submission. Speaking to intercessors today, because this has been epidemic in our groups, because of the nature of the prophetic, sometimes, you know, we think we know more than the leadership because God has shown us so many different things. And so then when it comes to submitting to the authority, maybe the rest of the congregation, and I do believe that intercession goes ahead. It's prophetic, so it goes ahead. And it's like the watchman, and they see ahead. And if it's treated properly and in the place and the position and the office that God has given it, then the intercession will cause things, traps and assignments against the body of Christ to be defeated before it ever comes. He'll show you the plans and the strategy of the enemy. If you'll be a person whom he can trust, he'll show you ahead of time what the enemy's plans are. You can take that into prayer and intercession, and it will not happen. What the church has done has been, we've been, instead of the head, we've been the tail, cleaning up the mess after everything happens. But if intercession is moving in the way that God wants it to in the church, then it will clean up the mess before through prayer, okay? But lack of submission because of the feeling of being so spiritual. Many intercessors go off on their own, and they do not join in groups. Do we know that? Anybody know what I'm talking about? What do they say? Well, I only go where God leads me. They will not attach themselves to a local body. They will not submit to the authorities. Now, they may have valid gifts. They may have valid prophetic movement in their life, but they will never be successful in God until they learn submission. Submitting to the leaders, submitting to the different departments, being the humblest person in the entire church. The last thing is the spiritual pride. Paul said that he could have had spiritual pride if he didn't have a thorn in his flesh to keep him from it because of the abundance of revelation. So those are the three things. Write them down, intercessors. Let them get in your spirit. Write them down. Don't be guilty. Because that crystal clear highway leads right up to the throne of God. So the intercession with the humility and the purity of spirit in those that carry the intercession will lead the souls right up to the Father's throne. You say, how does that happen? I don't know. We worship, and God brings in the sinners. I shared last week about an experience, and I think it bears telling almost every week. How many of you are new here today? Okay. I'm going to give you an example. I understand, of course, that Lucifer, as we doctrinally interpret it, was the praise and worship leader in heaven, right? So when we worship, we thoroughly and totally and completely dethrone him. We fill his position. That's why if you're going to have problems in your church, it'll usually be in your worship department. Uh-huh. That's it. You almost always, because there is such tremendous power. Worship is eternal. We're not going to have any more preachers. There aren't going to be any more evangelists. There won't be any more tongues or prophecy, interpretation, anything like that. But praise and worship is what we start here, but it's eternal and it will go with us forever and continue on forever. The only thing that we can take into heaven with us are the souls that we bring to Christ and the worship and praise. I want to so know Him here that when the time comes, the trump sounds, or I go through the grave, however it is, that it's not going to be any big surprise, that all I have to do is step over. Glory to God. And I believe that we can live that close to the Lord. He is about doing something tremendous in the body of Christ right now. So this worship, you know, you do get a little bit of criticism. In fact, I was speaking. How many of you know who Bobby Jean Merck is? Yeah, she called me a couple of mornings ago and we were talking. She's getting ready to go to Europe and do some meetings. And we were talking about the worship. She says, well, you know, I tried to introduce that because she's a woman that greatly moves. And she tried to introduce the worshiping warfare time quite a few years ago. And she said, I mean, I hit a wall. She said, it was not the time. But now seems to be the time that our hearts and our minds are open to understand that God has ways that we haven't understood before, and they're new ways. Woo. Thank you, Lord. I'd come back from a trip in Michigan to Michigan, and because it does come as quite a surprise when you're not doing warfare to bind spirits, and you're just worshiping and praising the Lord and waiting until He has you do that type thing. And maybe you won't at all. Maybe the person, intercessor will get the intercession and do it in the groaning or the birthing or something along that line. And so I was looking for confirmation. I had finished doing a meeting up in Michigan. And as I'm coming back on the plane, I was sitting behind a young man who was witnessing to the stewardess. And I mean, he was just really witnessing to her. He was just talking to her and telling her about how he got saved and delivered from drugs. And he said when he hit the floor, he was, you know, set free and all that. So I'm, you know, listening. It sounds real good to me. And she's going, yeah, yeah, yeah. You know, I got to serve the peanuts. Anyway, we meet each other at the baggage claim. And so I walked up to him and I said, you know, I couldn't help overhearing you witnessing to that stewardess. I said, what are you doing here? He said, oh, he says, there's a big revival going on here. He said, man, it's down here at the church in Pensacola. And he says, people are being saved and God's really moving, you know. And this is my first time here and I want to go and I want to get touched. You know, and he's just pouring it out to me. So that told me that when he hit the floor, it wasn't Pensacola. This was his first trip. So I said, well, I heard you share with the stewardess, if you don't mind my being, you know, being so nosy, which I didn't care whether you minded or not. I was going to get the news, man. So anyway, he said that he told me that he was at home. It was about the first of last year in 96. And he was not thinking about God, not praying, hadn't thought about God for a long time. Farthest thing from his mind. He was trying to figure out how he's going to get enough drugs, the money to buy the drugs to get him through the evening. And he was not a down-and-outer. He was kind of an up-and-outer. So he said he had decided, okay, I'll borrow the money from my sister, and then I can get to the bank tomorrow, and I can pay her back. He said as he reached for the phone, he was violently thrown to the floor. And when he came up from the floor, he was saved, set free, and never had another drug. Hallelujah! Nobody prayed for him. Nobody laid hands on him. God zapped him. So he said for about 2 weeks he wandered around, you know, thinking, oh, God, you know, stopped all of heaven to touch me. You know, you must have some great work for me, oh, God. And he said he figured that the Lord had enough of that, you know, got a little tired of that. And he said, you know, Wayne, he said it had absolutely nothing to do with you. He said there was a woman. Woo! She was worshiping. She was praising. She was worshiping. She was praising. And she got into my throne room. And he said, it so filled me with the pleasure of her worship and her praise. I turned to her and I said, what do you want? And she said, I want Wayne. And he said, you got him. Bam! I know that wasn't me, but I do, and probably whoever, he doesn't think he knows the woman. And he turned out to be a friend of Lyndall Cooley's, our worship leader, and I just saw him a few weeks ago whenever Lyndall got married, and I said, "You still going on?" He went, yes, ma'am, still praising the Lord, because he said he was sharing with his sister what had happened, and his sister happened to be a Christian. She said, "Oh, that was me." She says, "I've been praying for you for a long time." He said, "Well, it wasn't you. It was somebody, a lady worshiping and praising and worshiping and praising, and it so pleased the Father, hallelujah, that he hit me." Now, I don't understand how it works, but she got into his throne room, see? And whatever you ask, whoo! I want you to know that the river is deepening. We have been what we call in the river. Pastor says that it's a literal river that you feel. Sometimes you do. I can feel the current. It like moves around in here. I want you to know that at the first of the year, Pastor Kilpatrick had Dick Rubin go all the way to the top up there of the balcony. Michael Brown went over here to the water baptism. They stretched symbolically a big tape measure, measuring out more, hallelujah, more of the river of God. But I want you to hear me today. When we get in the river, as we call it, or in the moving of the Holy Spirit, whatever metaphor, that's just a metaphorical, symbolic term, though that river, I've felt it. I don't understand it. It's going to cost us, folks. It's wonderful when the river first comes because there's the great joy and you're splashing around and you're just enjoying this, the refreshing and all that. But I want you to know that when it deepens, when it's out of the ankle deep, when it's out of the knee deep, when it's out of the loin deep, when it's waters to swim in, it's going to cost you everything. You know, Jesus said to count the cost before you go to war, to count the cost before you build a house, that he used as a parable. And I'm telling you today, count the cost. It's going to cost you everything. Here at Revival, we have no life of our own anymore. And this is just the beginning. It's worth every minute of it. God, I wake up every morning and I say, "I kiss you, Jesus. I kiss you, Lord, for letting us be alive at this time." We live at the culmination, I believe, of the age, where all the loose ends are going to be tied up, folks. All of the intercession that is carried from generation to generation. Now remember, intercession is also eternal. Jesus prayed the high priestly prayer, and he said, "And for all of those that you will give me." So his intercession, even there when he was praying over his apostles, carries to us today, that he's praying for us today. I believe Paul, with his great hunger and concern and burden for Israel, and there's a stirring in Israel now, but there's going to be a tremendous outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Oh, like hasn't been since the days of the apostles. Going to hit Jerusalem and Israel. Whoo! Hallelujah! You got some Israel people here. Glory to God. Wherever God has touched, where the apostles went and they founded works, I call those the footprints of the Lord. Wherever God has touched mightily by his Holy Spirit, he's going to revisit those places. Glory to God. He has touched our mighty nation in many places. And we have been looking at what the devil has done. That we have been looking at where the devil has done all of his evil work. The Lord wants us to see and to look for where he has moved. You see, the enemy would cause us to concentrate on him, and then it becomes overwhelming. We talk about the powers and principalities and rulers of darkness over areas. I've done that. been there. I've mapped. I've searched out the roots. I've found out what powers and principalities. You know, we've been there. We've done that. And that's valid. I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. But what we have a tendency to do then is to concentrate on the enemy. What we need to see is that God has left his image wherever he's touched, wherever he's moved, and he created, hallelujah, the earth, didn't he? And before the foundations of the world, the Lamb was slain. Hallelujah. So his blood, glory to God, has been touched all over the earth because of the nail prints in his hand. Think on that one. The blood of the martyrs. Blood has a voice, remember. I'm not off in false doctrine, folks. Remember when Abel and Cain had their encounter and the Lord showed up? He said to Cain, he says, where's your brother? He said, am I my brother's keeper? He says, his voice speaks to me. So the blood, out of the blood, the spilled blood had a voice. Glory to God. The martyrs that have gone on, remember, tells us in Revelation that the martyrs are underneath the throne, underneath the altar, crying out, how long, oh God, how long? He says, not till the rest of them that are going to join you. But they have a voice. Whoo, wherever, I say John Knox. Oh, the blood of John Knox that was shed has a voice over that nation. Whoo, speaking. And what would the revenge of the missionaries be? To see the harvest come in. It'd be not to avenge their death in striking the people dead, but to avenge or to validate their death, hallelujah, by bringing in a mighty harvest. Paul, he carried an intercession for his people Israel. And I believe it's been bottled up. See, it tells us in the book of Revelation that the prayers and the worship is like memorials set before the throne of God. They're set there before the throne of God for him to move on in his own time. Say, oh, Sister Lila, you sound like you're really way out there. How many of you are here because of a praying grandmother or a great-grandmother or because in your family they were Christians? See, I've prayed for my children and my children's children and my children's children's children. I pray that now. I've spoken into my children, your seed. And some of them aren't serving the Lord right now, but I remind them, your seed belongs to the Lord because your seed belongs to me. Glory to God. And I belong to the Lord. Whether I die or whether I live, it makes no difference. Your seed belongs to the kingdom of God. The Lord has said to 1,000 generations would our seed be blessed. And we've been hung up on the curses that are to the third and the fourth. Let's get kingdom mentality, folks. Hallelujah. Let's let God rip the blinders off of our eyes so that we can see. I was in Washington, D.C. I was invited to participate and to be a part of the inaugural prayer breakfast in Washington, D.C. And it was a great honor for me. And they asked me to pray over the nations. And it was my great delight. But that night, the next night, I was holding some meetings there in Maryland. With Ruth Heflin. You know who Ruth Heflin is? Does anybody know Ruth Heflin? She wrote the book Glory. Awesome. She's the one that really touched me with first the praise, then the worship, then the glory. In that, and talking about the ease of moving into the things that God wants and how he will move through the ease more than the works that we've been doing. So we were doing a meeting together, and it was on a Tuesday night. And I had shared, my husband had shared, and then Ruth was sharing, and then she began to worship and to release the glory, and she has a tremendous gift in that way. And the Spirit of God just began to move through the entire congregation. So she asked me to come up, and I was just enjoying myself. I stand down in the altar space worshiping. She asked me to come up on the platform with her to pray and to minister with her. And I said, no, just come on up. When I got up, oh, there was such an awesome presence of the Lord. It began to bend me backwards. I know. Look at us strange. We are. I mean, you know, I don't even apologize anymore. You have to realize I was mainstream Assemblies of God. Hello? That's kind of an inside joke on we Assemblies of God. Anyway, I mean, if, you know, if I knew it was scriptural and I had studied it out in the Greek and the Hebrew, and then I got five witnesses to that, then I might do it, right? Threw all caution to the wind when we came here. I said, God, I know this is you. I've seen you do so many things, I don't have to, you know, I don't have to question it. It's not the devil that saves and sets people free. I mean, it's wonderful to be in revival this long and to watch the people that come to the altar, in my own family members that come to the altar and get saved and their lives changed. And they're set free from drugs and they're in Bible school. My grandson came here from California so terribly messed up, both of them. And I see them at night worshiping. One of them, he's a tall, you know, kind of 17. You know, he's real tall, but he hasn't filled in to go with it. And I see his head jumping up and down like a pogo stick at night as he's worshiping the Lord. Hallelujah. No amount of coercion, no amount of talking to the kid, no amount of, you know, whatever. It didn't do any good, but the Holy Ghost can do more in 1 second than all the counseling and all of the badgering. So I felt myself being bent over backwards, and I kept trying to straighten up, you know. So anyway, I'm standing there, and she just walked by and just went like that, and I'm gone. No catcher, no nothing. And I'm out. And oh, that was the best time I ever had praying for people, because she did it all. She went through and prayed for the whole group while I'm flat on my back. But while I am laying on that platform, and at first I felt like I was in the river, the peace, and I was just swimming along, you know, floating along, no cares in the world. I tried to open my eyes, and all I could see was like water over me. I said, oh, geeminy, I'm underneath the water. What's going on here? I'm still breathing, you know. And then I realized I was going into deeper and deeper and deeper waters, and I thought, Lord, I'm going to die. And a few weeks before that, an intercession one night, well, I just began to speak out, and I don't even know where.